So the Bible talks about two resurrections. When are they? And how do we get included? Let's talk about that today on Extraordinary Evidence. Throughout his amazing book, Daniel has been giving us more and more detail about events in the four earthly kingdoms, Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome, which would lead up to the New Covenant or the Messianic Kingdom. Chapters 10 through 12 form a unit that's parallel to chapter 7 and chapter 2. Daniel will give us a tremendous amount of detail to fill in the gaps of the earlier prophecies. This prophecy runs from Persia up to the first Jewish-Roman War, which was the Great Tribulation or the Days of Vengeance in judgment for the sins of idolatry and bloodshed on the kingdom of Judah. Remember what we saw in Revelation 17 verses 16 and 17 regarding that war. And the 10 horns which you saw and the beast, these will hate the prostitute and will make her desolate and naked and will eat her flesh and will burn her up with fire. For the Lord has put it in their hearts to execute his purpose by having a common purpose and by giving their kingdom to the beast until the words of God will be fulfilled. The beast, or Rome under Emperor Vespasian, with the assistance of the 10 horns or the client kings who sent troops to the campaign, destroyed Jerusalem and much of Judea in that war at the end of the pivotal 40-year generation that started with the ministry and crucifixion of Christ. However, today, we're shifting from judgment to reward. Those days of vengeance for killing the prophets were also the time when the messengers and prophets and the righteous of Israel were raised to life and given their reward. In Revelation 11, when the seventh trumpet sounded, it says, "And the nations were enraged, and your wrath came. And the time came for the dead to be judged, and the time to reward your bondservants, the prophets, and the saints, and those who fear your name, the small and the great, and to destroy those who destroy the earth." We'll see how this resurrection here at the destruction of Jerusalem is the same resurrection Daniel was speaking of in chapter 12. Chapter 12, verse 13 says, "But as for you, go your way to the end. Then you will rest, and you will rise for your allotted portion at the end of the age." Again, the end of the temple age, the end of the kingdom of Judah, not the end of time. So let's take a look. In verse 1 of chapter 10, we're told this passage is about the coming conflict or war. In the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a message was revealed to Daniel, who was named Belteshazzar. And the message was true and one of great conflict. But he understood the message and had an understanding of the vision. The word for conflict here is Saba. It can be translated as war, conflict, or army. Again, chapter 12 culminates with the Great Tribulation or the Jewish-Roman War. But as we can see by the writing of this prophecy, Persia had already conquered Babylon. So the passage starts with Persia. And the way Daniel 11 works is that he highlights various figures in each of the empire's lines of kings. Then he shows an interaction between the current kingdom he's speaking of and the subsequent kingdom. Then the prophecy flows into the subsequent kingdom. For example, look at verse 2. "Now I will tell you the truth. Behold, three more kings are going to arise in Persia." Cyrus conquered Babylon in 539 BC, so this would be around 536 BC. The kings that succeeded him were Cambyses II, Bardia, and Darius I. It says, "Then a fourth king will gain far more riches than all of them." This fourth king would have been Xerxes I, and it says, "As soon as he becomes strong through his riches, he will arouse the whole empire against the realm of Greece." So in 479 BC, Xerxes attacked Greece. And here we have our interface between the two kingdoms, Greece and Persia. And now the prophecy flows into Greece. Verse 3, "And a mighty king will arise, and he will rule with great authority and do as he pleases." Here Daniel has jumped to highlight Alexander the Great, who took the throne of Greece in 336 BC at the age of 20. Greece defeated Persia in 331 BC and became the New World power. But it says, "As soon as he has risen, his kingdom will be broken up and parceled out to the four points of the compass, though not to his own descendants, nor according to his authority which he wielded. For his sovereignty will be uprooted and given to others besides him." Alexander died in 323 BC, and his kingdom was divided between his generals, Ptolemy, Cassander, Seleucus, and Lysimachus. From here, the kings over the region of Egypt, who were called the Ptolemies, considered south of Jerusalem, are referred to as the King of the South. The kings to the north of Jerusalem, the Seleucids, were referred to as the king of the north. Even though the text says king in the singular, it's not speaking of one singular king throughout. Daniel is prophesying highlights that would happen to figures within the lines of each of the respective kingdoms. A good Bible commentary will show which king was being prophesied in each of the verses, so we won't go into all those details. Let's jump down to verse 21. Speaking of a Seleucid king of the north, he says, "In his place a despicable person will arise, on whom the honor of kingship has not been conferred, but he will come in a time of tranquility and seize the kingdom by intrigue." Antiochus IV Epiphanes, the brother of the rightful heir, succeeded the Seleucid throne in 175 BC with the help of Eumenes II, king of Pergamon. And it says, "At the appointed time, he, Antiochus Epiphanes, the Seleucid king of the north, will return and come into the south, Egypt, the land of the Ptolemies. But this last time, it will not turn out the way it did before, for ships of Kittim will come against him." So here now we have the interface between the two kingdoms of Greece and Rome. Daniel is setting up the next shift in world power. Kittim is the name the Jews use for Rome. Rome told Antiochus to stand down in his invasion of Egypt. Roman ambassador Gaius Pompilius Lanus drew a circle around him and told him not to step out of the circle until he gave his answer to the Roman Senate. So Antiochus decided to back down, and today historians call this the Day of Eleusis, and it's prophesied right here in Daniel. "Therefore, he will be disheartened and will return and become enraged at the Holy Covenant and take action. So he will come back and show regard to those who forsake the Holy Covenant. Some of those who have insight will fall, in order to refine, purge, and make them pure until the end time, because it is still to come at the appointed time." According to the book of 2 Maccabees, in the space of 3 days, 80,000 were lost, 40,000 meeting a violent death, and the same number being sold into slavery. While this was an extremely difficult and trying time for the Jews, it wasn't their end. The end was still to come. So with the interaction between Kittim or Rome being introduced in verse 30, we now see the prophecy shift to Rome, starting in verse 36 and flowing all the way to the end of chapter 12. Now, we already determined the list of our kings when we looked at chapter 7. They were Pompey, Julius, Augustus, Tiberius, Caligula, Claudius, Nero, Galba, Otho, Vitellius, and Vespasian. And we'll see in Daniel 11, he highlights kings from Pompey to Nero, who was the emperor at the very start of the Great Tribulation, the first Jewish-Roman War. So verse 36 says, "Then the king..." And just like the kingdoms above, this is speaking of the line of Roman kings, not a singular king. "The king will do as he pleases, and he will exalt and magnify himself above every god, and will speak monstrous things against the God of gods." Roman emperors were worshipped as gods, starting with Julius Caesar. They actually had temples and statues to them. Claudius actually tried to put a statue of himself inside the Jewish temple. And Nero Caesar, whose name matches 666, the number of the beast in Revelation, had a giant statue of himself, which is also alluded to in the book of Revelation. The Roman emperor cult was being prophesied here hundreds of years before it happened. "And he will prosper until the indignation is finished, for that which is decreed will be done." The decree was the destruction of Jerusalem. Indignation is the word used to speak of God's wrath, specifically here against the Jewish nation for their sin under the law. "Prosper until the indignation is finished" is consistent with other passages that show the beasts of Rome being thrown into the furnace in Daniel 7, or the lake of fire in Revelation. It means once God's judgment against Judah was complete, the usefulness of Rome as an instrument of that judgment would be complete, and their dominion over the people of God, the saints, would be taken away. And history shows that from the time of the destruction of Jerusalem by the Romans, the gospel spread rapidly throughout the world, even overtaking the Roman Empire itself. Just as Daniel chapter 2 verses 34 and 35 prophesied, the stone is becoming a mountain that will continue to fill the entire earth. Verse 37 says, "He will show no regard for the God of his fathers or for the desire of women, nor will he show regard for any other God, but he will magnify himself above them all." Again, we have Roman emperor worship here. "But instead he will honor a God of fortresses, a God whom his fathers did not know. He will honor with gold, silver, costly stones, and treasures. He will take action against the strongest fortresses with the help of a foreign god." Roman soldiers actually worshipped and sacrificed to their standards. When Vespasian's son Titus destroyed the temple, the soldiers set up their standards there and worshipped them. At the time of Augustus, worship of Mars, their god of war, also peaked, and Mars was considered the guardian and the avenger of Caesar. So he will give honor to those who acknowledge him, and he will cause them to rule over many, and will parcel out land for a price. Rome had a provincial governing style with client kings and governors whom they themselves would select and establish. Now we come to verse 40, and it speaks of the end time. And remember in verse 35, under Greece, we were told the end was still to come. Now we're actually coming up to the time of the end of the age. The king of the south will collide with him, and the king of the north will storm out against him with chariots, with horsemen, and with many ships, and he will enter countries, overflow, and pass through them. This is an overview statement that sets up the actions that we will see from the Caesars. So let's take a look. Verse 41, it says, he will enter the beautiful land, and many countries will fall, but these will be rescued out of his hand, Edom, Moab, and the foremost of the sons of Ammon. So Pompey the Great conquered many regions, overflowing many lands, as the passage says. The beautiful land is Judea, or Jerusalem. In 63 BC, Pompey made Judea a vassal state of Rome. Edom, Moab, and Ammon were under Nabatean control, and the Nabateans worked out an agreement with Pompey to remain independent. They weren't annexed until much later under Emperor Trajan. Then he will stretch out his hand against other countries, and the land of Egypt will not escape. The passage here shifts to Octavian, who would later receive the name Caesar Augustus. Octavian defeated Antony and Cleopatra in the Battle of Actium, and in the process gained control of Egypt. But he will gain control over the hidden treasures of gold and silver and over the precious things of Egypt. Octavian used his newly gained Egyptian wealth to pay his veteran soldiers. And the Libyans and Ethiopians will follow at his heels. Now, after gaining control of Egypt, Augustus unsuccessfully sent one of his generals to subdue these countries. But rumors from the east and from the north will disturb him. And now the passage shifts to Nero Caesar. At the end of his reign, there were revolts in Gaul in the north and Judea in the east. And he will go forth with great wrath to destroy and annihilate many. He will pitch the tents of his royal pavilion between the seas and the beautiful holy mountain. This was 66 AD and the start of the Jewish-Roman War. Nero first sent Cestius Gallus to put down the revolt in Judea, but he was unsuccessful. He made his approach on Jerusalem, but he inexplicably turned away and left. This corresponds to Jesus' words in the New Testament. When you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, flee to the mountains. Josephus, an eyewitness of the war, records that when Cestius retreated, many Jews fled the city. After Cestius was unsuccessful, Nero sent Vespasian, a very experienced general, to put down the revolt. And it says, yet he will come to his end and no one will help him. The Senate lost confidence in Nero, declared him enemy of the state, and sentenced him to death. He committed suicide rather than being executed. So now we have a general idea of what period in Jewish history is being prophesied here. Let's see what Daniel 12 says would happen at that time. Verse 1. Now at that time, at what time? The time of Nero's suicide. It says, Michael the great prince who stands guard over the sons of your people will arise, and there will be a time of distress or tribulation such as never occurred since there was a nation until that time. Jesus actually echoed these words when he pointed to the same war at the end of his generation. Matthew 24 verses 21 and 22. For then there will be great tribulation, such as has not occurred from the beginning of the world until now, nor ever will again. And if those days had not been cut short, no life would have been saved. But for the sake of the elect, the days will be cut short. And then in verse 34, he says, truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until these things take place. So Jesus was looking forward to the same judgment that Daniel had prophesied hundreds of years before. But Daniel, just like Jesus and many of the prophets, foretold that there would be a remnant. They would not all be destroyed in this judgment. And at that time, your people, everyone who is found written in the book, will be rescued. Again, Jesus echoed these words, the elect, those whose names were written in the book of remembrance, would be rescued or spared from the judgment. And now we get to the reward. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the ground will awake, these to everlasting life, but the others to disgrace and everlasting contempt. And those who have insight will shine like the glow of the expanse of heaven, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. But as for you, Daniel, keep these words secret and seal up the book until the time of the end. Many will roam about and knowledge will increase. So we have here the first resurrection, the reward of the messengers, the martyrs, and the righteous, just as Revelation shows at the time of the fall of Jerusalem. Jesus also places this resurrection at the end of his generation. It says in verse 31 of Matthew 24, "And he will send forth his angels with a great trumpet blast, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds and from one end of the sky to the other." Jesus is speaking of the time of the destruction of Jerusalem, referencing Isaiah 27, which also places resurrection at the fall of Jerusalem. Look at verse 10 of Isaiah 27. "For the fortified city is isolated, a homestead deserted and abandoned like the desert. There the calf will graze, and there it will lie down and feed on its branches. When its limbs are dry, they are broken off. Women come and make a fire with them. For they are not a people of discernment. Therefore their maker will not have compassion on them, and their creator will not be gracious to them. On that day, the day the city is left desolate, the Lord will thresh from the flowing stream of the Euphrates River to the brook of Egypt, and you will be gathered up one by one, you sons of Israel." Verse 13, "It will come about also on that day that a great trumpet will be blown, and those who were perishing in the land of Assyria and who were scattered in the land of Egypt will come and worship the Lord on the holy mountain of Jerusalem." This is the same language Jesus used of resurrection in Matthew 24. So let's map it out on the big chart. Again, after the great city, Mystery Babylon, or Jerusalem, is destroyed, Revelation 20 says, "Then I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was given to them. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony of Jesus and because of the word of God, and those who had not worshiped the beast or his image and had not received the mark on their foreheads and on their hands. And they came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were completed. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is the one who takes part in the first resurrection. Over these, the second death has no power, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. And let's jump down to verse 11. "Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose presence earth and heaven fled, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, the great and the small, standing before the throne, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged from the things which were written in the books according to their deeds. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to their deeds. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire." So let's compare this to what Paul says of resurrection in 1 Corinthians 15, starting at verse 23. Of resurrection, he says, "But each in his own order, Christ the firstfruits, after that, those who are Christ at his coming." The word coming there is parousia, the same word used in Matthew 24, of which Jesus said would be at the end of his generation, his coming in judgment on Judah. "Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to our God and Father, when he has abolished all rule and authority and power." So the end comes when Christ has abolished all rule, authority, and power. "For he must reign until he has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be abolished is death." So this is the same process we saw in Revelation chapter 20. The first resurrection is behind us. The second resurrection is in front of us. Jesus is currently reigning and all things are being placed under his feet, abolishing all rule and authority. And we wait for a time when even death itself is destroyed. So how do we know the first resurrection happened when we couldn't see it? We have confidence because of all the things that were prophesied to have happened at that time, and we can see them and verify them. In the meantime, we have a great promise from the book of Revelation, Revelation 14:13. "And I heard a voice from heaven saying, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on," from the time of the destruction of Jerusalem. "Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, so that they may rest from their labors, for their deeds will follow them." Well, thanks for listening and good luck on your journey exploring all the extraordinary evidence. We believe there's a mountain of evidence, so let's start at the base and climb all the way to the top.